you for yet another opportunity of coming to your presence. Oh Lord, we pray that tonight again, open our eyes of understanding.
Amen.
To understand the mysteries of the gospel.
Amen.
And as you are speaking to us, to be able to comprehend what the Spirit is saying to the church in this end time, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Because we know you've answered.
Thank
in
you, Lord.
In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We're looking tonight on the message, looking on to our excellent wonder. In Hebrews chapter 12, in verse 2, the Bible says, looking on to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame. And he sat down, and he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God, looking unto Jesus. I told you last week that Hebrews chapter 11 tells us about many heroes of faith. And then culminating says, well, even though they are very good examples, but we should look unto Jesus. And as we are starting this series, we are looking at the first person that was mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11, which was Abel. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 4, we are told, by faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it he, being dead, yet speaketh. So Hebrews tells us about how he offered a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. Let's read that story in Genesis chapter 4, so that as we begin to compare Abel and Jesus, you will see the reason why you are not to look up unto Abel, but to look up unto Jesus. In Genesis chapter 4, I read from verse 3. That tells us what he did. Genesis chapter 4, verse 3. And in the process of time, it came to pass that came.
Sir, you're muted, sir.
Genesis chapter 4, in verse 3. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the first of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering. But unto Cain and to his offering, he had not respect. And Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth? And why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shall thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, see light at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him. Now, this is where Cain and Abel offered unto the Lord. And in comparing the offering of Abel to that of Cain, the Bible says, Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. It was a comparison with the one of Cain. As you read, Abel offered this sacrifice, a lamb of the flock. But as you compare him with Jesus, what do you see? The Bible says that Jesus is the Lamb of God who taketh away the sins of the world. Look at John chapter 1, verse 29. The offering of Jesus as the Lamb of God Abel offered a lamb for sacrifice. Jesus is the Lamb of God offered in sacrifice. But you could see the difference between the two offerings. In John chapter 1, verse 29, the next day, John said Jesus coming unto him and said, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. The sacrifice of Jesus was sufficient to take away the sins of the world. But do you realize that the sacrifice of Abel, look at Hebrews chapter 10, in verse 4, this as excellent as the sacrifice of Abel was, this is the end of it. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 4, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins.
Yes.
Abel offered that lamb. Yes, that was what God, has stipulated. He was just being obedient. But the Bible says the blood of that lamb could not take away sins. But Jesus, the Lamb of God, crucified for us at Calvary, sacrificed for us at Calvary, the Bible says, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. So you could see the sacrifice of Abel and the sacrifice of Jesus, far more excellent. And that's why we can't look unto Abel, but we can look unto Jesus. He's the Lamb of God, offered for us, and whose blood is able to take away the sins of the whole world. Abel offered, another. Do you realize that when Abel was going to offer, he offered another thing? He offered a lamb. He didn't offer himself. He offered a substitute for himself in sacrifice. But Jesus offered himself in sacrifice for the whole world. Can you see the difference? Abel had to kill an animal as a sacrifice. Jesus himself was the sacrifice. Abel's sacrifice, do you realize that was just one of the many sacrifices he would have had to offer during his entire lifetime, had he lived longer? Because Abel offered that sacrifice on that day. Another 1 month's time, he will offer another sacrifice. Another 3 months' time, he will offer another sacrifice. And that sacrifice will continue the whole of his life. It was just the first of a lot of sacrifices he would have had to make in a lifetime. You realize that Jesus' sacrifice was only once, and that's it. Once and for all, not a repeated sacrifice. And in that respect, you see the sacrifice of Jesus better than the sacrifice of Abel. Jesus' sacrifice, in the case of Abel, it was just a sacrifice. One of the many he would have to do. But Jesus' sacrifice is not a sacrifice, or one of the many sacrifices that we'll have to do. It was the sacrifice. It was the sacrifice that ends all sacrifices. Jesus' sacrifice was the final sacrifice. Now, as great as Abel is, offering an excellent sacrifice by faith, we thank God for that, yet we are not to look unto Abel, but to look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Jesus did not only offer himself, he himself did not only offer sacrifice, he himself is a sacrifice. Like I said, a sacrifice is not just a sacrifice, it is the sacrifice. A sacrifice is not just one of many sacrifices, it is the only sacrifice. It is the final sacrifice to end and abolish all sacrifices. Abel was an excellent worshiper, but Jesus is our excellent wonder. And as we look at it tonight, he has shed that blood for us. He has done that sacrifice for us. Let him be your sacrifice, the only sacrifice, the final sacrifice that ends all sacrifices. And for those who are maybe on the platform, sometimes you are still weak and you have a problem, and then they will tell you, well, there is one Baba somewhere in Nigeria, in Ghana, in Kutonu. If you go to him, if he just does one little sacrifice, all your problems will be gone. Jesus is his final sacrifice that ends all sacrifices. All those sacrifices are satanic, demonic sacrifices that can avail nothing. The final sacrifice, the only effective sacrifice, has been offered. And from that time, no more sacrifice is needed. As we look tonight, I'm praying that you'll be able to put your faith in the sacrifice, in the only sacrifice, in the final sacrifice, and you will be benefited by it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Paul said that. Are there not things we can learn from Abel? Of course, yes. We can learn from Abel as an excellent worshiper. We can learn from how Abel offered a sacrifice to improve our worship, to improve the way we approach God. We can learn. And that's the first point. Learning from an excellent worshiper. Because Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. And the Bible says it was by that sacrifice he obtained witness. He obtained witness that he was righteous. God even acknowledging and testifying of his gifts. And he, by that gift, he, by that sacrifice, even though he's dead, is yet speaking. He's speaking to you and say, look at how I offered and God acknowledged it. You can offer like that and acknowledge it. That's why his sacrifice, even though Abel is dead, but his sacrifice is still speaking unto us. And tonight we are learning from it. He said, you can be an excellent worshiper like I was an excellent worshiper. God can acknowledge your gifts like he acknowledged my own. You can obtain witness that you are righteous the way I obtained witness that I was righteous. God can testify of your sacrifice the way he testified of my sacrifice. He, by that sacrifice, being dead, yet speaketh. What are the things that we're going to learn tonight? The sacrifice of Abel, like I said, is detailed in that Genesis chapter 4, verses 3 to 7. There are many things we can learn from Abel in order to improve and fine-tune our worship. My brother, thank God for how you've been worshiping God with the knowledge that you have, and God is saying you are faithful. My sister, thank God the way you have been serving God, and God is saying you are faithful. But you can do better. You can go higher. You can worship God in a better way. That's why we are learning. Let's look at this excellent worshiper. The person that offered a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, how did he do it? So that we know how we can do it and what we can do. Number one, Abel followed God's established order. That's the first thing we learn from the sacrifice of Abel. And what happened? Genesis chapter 3, because let's begin to see how did God acknowledge that did right, but Cain did not. Genesis chapter 3, in verse 6. Genesis chapter 3, verse 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired, to make one wise, what did she do? The Bible says she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband. And he did eat. And the eyes of them both were open, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. Immediately after the fall, Adam and Eve, they knew they were naked. They used fig leaves to cover their nakedness. You know, but God came later and said, yes, I can see what you are doing, but you are wrong. You can see that you are physically naked, but you cannot see that you are spiritually naked. And God said, you are covering physical nakedness, but you have not covered spiritual nakedness. You can see, even look at what you are wearing, even fig leaves, holes all over the place. We can even still Even that nakedness is not completely covered, it's just partial. But it's worthless if you have not covered spiritually. So what did God do? Look at verse 21. Verse 21. So God showed them this is the way to do it. 21. Genesis chapter 4, in verse, chapter 3, verse 21. Unto Adam also and to his wife did the Lord God make coats of skins and clothe them. So God clothed them, but I want you to see that God did coats of skins. Before you take the skin of an animal to be able to use it to make clothes for them, that animal was sacrificed. That animal was killed. The first thing that God did was to make an atonement for them. He killed the animal. The blood of the animal, he used it to make an atonement for them so that their spiritual nakedness is covered. Then after the spiritual nakedness is covered, God went ahead and then covered their nakedness, made them coats of skin. So God was setting a pattern and saying, next time, when you are falling, you don't go and just concentrate on covering physical nakedness. You must first of all cover your spiritual nakedness. Then when your sins have been forgiven, your spiritual nakedness has been covered, then you can go ahead and cover your physical nakedness. That was the divine order. God showed Adam and Eve, this is what to do. So that's important. God killed an animal, use the blood for atonement for them to cover their spiritual nakedness. Afterward, God used the animal skin to make coats of skin to cover their physical nakedness. God was establishing the priority, the order, that the covering of spiritual nakedness must take priority before the covering of physical nakedness. Now, even though it was Adam and Eve that God did, it was an established order. Now, when it was time for Abel and Cain to offer, Abel said, well, God has already established an order. We knew what he told and corrected our parents. So he brought the firstling of his flock and he offered blood and he offered it to cover his spiritual nakedness. But Cain brought the fruit of the ground, yams and cocoyam and potato, bloodless sacrifice, and God did not. And God said, but I already established an order. I showed your parents. How come you are doing this? And when Cain saw that his offering was not accepted, God told him, where is your countenance falling? If you did right like Abel did, I would have accepted you. But if not, you know, people normally think when you read that passage, let me show you in Genesis chapter 4, in verse 7, in verse 6, Genesis chapter 4, because I want to explain it to you. The Bible says, and the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth? And why is thy countenance fallen? If thou doest well, shall thou not be accepted? And if thou doest not well, see light at the door. Some people don't understand that. It's not talking about sin as by iniquity. It's just the translation. It's talking about sin offering. That if you did well, I would have accepted you. But you can still correct yourself. You can still offer a lamb like Abel offered. Sin offering is all over the place. It's there for you. And then look at what it says. And unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him. God says, look, that sin offering, that animal is given to you. If you read the Leviticus chapter 7, God said, I've given it unto you to make an atonement for your soul. So God was telling me, the animal is there, his desire is unto you. You can rule over it, you can take it and sacrifice. But Cain decided, no, if God didn't accept my sacrifice and he accepted Abel's, I'm not going to redo it. Instead, I will kill Abel. Very rebellious. God is saying you can redo it. Do it the proper way. Do it according to the established order. But Cain will not. He just killed his brother. So the first thing we learn from Abel is that he followed God's established order. My brother, if you want to be an excellent worshiper, you need to follow God's established order. How does God say we should follow him? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's God's established order. If you go and do it like Jacob, you build house for yourself. You build house for your animals, stalls for your animals. And then later you build an altar for God and call it El Elohi Israel. He will reject it because his established order is seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Follow God's established order if you want to be an excellent worshiper. Do exactly like Abel. God has set a pattern. He has told you what to do. You need to follow it. If you follow it, you'll be learning from Abel. Number two, Abel offered the firstling of the flock for sacrifice. The Bible says he offered the firstling of the flock. Abel shows us that we ought to offer God the first and the best. A great God deserves a great gift. Abel gave of his best, and we ought to give of our best. You know, when you read the Malachi chapter 1, God said, look at all these animals you brought to me, maimed, lame, blind, spotted. God said, give it to your governor. If man will not collect that from you, why are you bringing that to me? And God told them in Malachi chapter 1, I'm a great God, I'm a great king, and my name is dreadful among the heathen, and a great God deserves a great gift. And Abel brought the firstling of the flock. Are you bringing your first? Are you bringing your best unto God? That's why God acknowledged his gift. That's why God, you know, had respect unto his offering. Malachi chapter 1, he did not have respect unto their offering because it was not the best. It was not the first. They just gave God anything that God said, no, I'm a great king. Go and read that passage. God said, I am a great king. How do you bring that for me? No, I will not accept it. Away with it. So Abel brought the firstling of the flock for sacrifice. He brought his best. He brought his first. And I'm asking you tonight, as you offer unto God, are you bringing your first? Are you bringing your best? Number two, now, atonement is only possible through the blood. That's another thing we learn. There is no other way. We can praise God. Praise will not take away sins. We can pray and fast. Prayer and fasting will not take away sins. We can rejoice before the Lord. Rejoicing will not take away sins. Only by the blood. Atonement is only possible through the blood. Sacrifice yam and cocoyam, it will not take away, it will not atone for your sin. You must sacrifice a lamb. Blood. That's another thing we are learning from Abel, that atonement is only possible through the blood. Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11. That was why Cain's sacrifice was rejected. You can atone for sin by offering yam, by offering cocoyam. No. And God said, go and redo it. Blood is needed. A bloodless sacrifice is no sacrifice. God says, no. Leviticus chapter 17, verse 11. It says, for the life of the flesh is in the blood. And I have given it to you upon the altar to make an atonement for your souls. For it is the blood that maketh an atonement for the soul. There is no other way. Atonement does not come any other way. Blood is essential and no other thing. Prayer is good, fasting is good, praise is good, rejoicing is good, worshiping God is good, but only the blood will wash away sins. Only the blood can bring forgiveness. Only the blood can bring redemption. Only the blood can cleanse you from sin. And Abel, we are learning from him that atonement is only possible through the blood. Hebrews chapter 9 in verse 22. So we are learning. You want to be an excellent worshiper? You can learn from Abel, because he was an excellent worshiper. He offered a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. And if you will follow his path, you also can offer a more excellent sacrifice than many people whose sacrifices have been rejected. In Hebrews chapter 9, I read verse 22. The Bible says, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood, what did he say?
There is no remission.
It's no remission.
Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Without the shedding of blood, there is no atonement anywhere. And that's another thing we are learning from Abel, that atonement is only possible through the blood. And Abel did that. Number four, Abel offered a sacrifice with a heart of gratitude, with a heart of thanksgiving. The Bible says he brought his best, the firstling of the flock. The Bible says he did it, you know, according to God's established order. He did it. Look at Hebrews chapter 11, verse 4, and see how God described it. And you also can do the same. You also can do the same. And you will find the case of, and I will show you what Cain did. And we want to offer sacrifice unto God in this way. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 4, by faith, Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous. God testifying of his gifts. God testifying of his gifts. My brother, when you offer unto God, when you sacrifice unto God, can God testify of your gifts? My brother, you earn €1,000 a month in the factory, then you come, you know, to the church, and God says, and then we say, it's time to offer unto the Lord, and you raise up 50 cents, and then you put it in the offering box. Can God testify of that? What kind of offering is that? From €1,000, you put 50 cents in the box, and you expect God to testify of those gifts. No, God testifies of the best. God testified of gifts that are first. God testified of gifts that are quality. God testified of gifts that are brought with a heart of gratitude, that even though I am lost, you have made a way for me to be found. Even though I'm a sinner, you've made a provision for me to be righteous and to become a saint. You bring it unto God with a heart of gratitude. That was why God acknowledged the offering of Abel. That was why God did not acknowledge the offering of the people in Malachi chapter 1. And they were offering, and God said, give it to the governor if he accepts you. But for this one, I have nothing to do with this kind of offering. God will not acknowledge or testify of those kind of gifts. That's important. God acknowledged Abel's sacrifice because he brought it with a heart of gratitude. But you know, Cain offered his sacrifice with grudge. Even when God said, look, Cain, I rejected your offering because it does not follow the order I've appointed. And God was correcting me. Cain will not take correction. And God said, well, if you do well like Abel did, I will accept you. I'm not partial God. He didn't listen. God said, there is sin offering there. You can do exactly what Abel did. Don't come and burn cocoyam and yam unto me. No bloodless sacrifice. See light at the door. His desire will be unto you. And, you know, but you will not. You will rule over him. The animal does not have a voice over you. You can take the animal and then sacrifice it. But Cain will not. Instead, he went his way. It's just for you to know that there was grudge. There was nonchalance. And, you know, look at Proverbs chapter 21, verse 27. What a wonderful passage. What a wonderful passage. And you should be measuring yourself by that passage. Proverbs chapter 21, verse 27. The Bible says, the sacrifice of the wicked. What is it?
It's abomination.
It's abomination. How much more when he bringeth it with a wicked mind? Already, an offering that is rejected, then it is like a double wahala. You know, by even with a wicked heart, he's compounding the problem. And that was Cain. The offering you are already bringing, blooded sacrifice, is already rejected. Then you are bringing me with a kind of grudge, grudge against God, grudge against your brother. Why did God accept my brother's offering and he did not accept my own? At least I'm the elder brother. I mean, is this God not partial? An offering that is already bad. Then you bring it with a bad mind. You know, it's like, you know, joining problem to problem. And Cain was like that. You know, there are some people like that also. Somebody that is pushing drug, and then he's coming to the church, and then he wants to give. And then already, the process of drug, God is saying, don't bring it to my house. But we don't, unfortunately, we don't know that he's pushing drug. Then he brings it, and then we say, everybody close your eyes and let us pray. And he says, God, you know, I'm not selfish. Out of that deal, what I got, I'm bringing this little to you. Shouldn't you be happy? Can you see that individual? A wicked, already a rejected offering. And then he's bringing it again with a kind of an arrogant heart. Just piling problem upon problem. Cain was like that. And I pray that you are not like that.
Amen.
You come to God, you come with a heart of gratitude. You are not bringing a rejected offering that again you bring it with a wicked mind. The Bible says the sacrifice of the wicked is abomination unto God. How much more when he now brings it with a wicked mind? What a concept. And some people, Cain was like that. That kind of offering, God will reject it. Double rejection. Rejection of the offering, rejected of the attitude of heart with which that offering is even brought. Two, the both are wrong. And when we bring offering unto God, the two must be right. Bring the right offering with the right attitude of mind. It's when you do that, that the offering can be accepted. You can bring a right offering with a wrong attitude of mind, the offering will still be rejected. The offering is good, but the attitude of mind is bad. That's why the Bible says, if there be first a willing mind, then whatever you bring is accepted according as a man has. Both must be right. Right offering and right attitude of mind. A wrong offering with a right attitude of mind is rejected. A right offering with a wrong attitude of mind is rejected. A wrong offering with a wrong attitude of mind is even doubly rejected. The offering that God wants is a right offering with a right attitude of mind. And the right attitude of mind is attitude of gratitude. There are people that have died. Some of them were not sick. They slept. They never woke up. Nobody knows any reason. When they do the autopsy, they said, it was not heart attack, it was not anything. The person just ceased breathing, and that's the end. They buried them alive. We are still alive. We are not better. I slept yesterday, you slept yesterday. We woke up this morning, the grace of God. So as we come to worship God, we're saying, God, thank you for another day. Thank you for health. Thank you for your provision. Thank you for opportunities. Thank you for keeping me alive. At this awesome time, we are offering unto God with the right attitude of mind. So what are the things we are learning from this excellent worshiper called Abel? Number one, he followed God's established order. And he said, established order. Number two, he offered the firstling of the flock for sacrifice. And he's telling you, my brother, when you offer, give God the first, give God the best. A great king deserves a great gift. Number three, atonement is only possible through the blood. Abel is telling you praying and fasting is good, praise is good, worship is good, but forgiveness only comes through the blood, atonement by the blood. And number four, Abel offered the sacrifice with a heart of gratitude and with a heart of thanksgiving. You know, that's how God told the children of Israel they must offer because of our time. When you read in Deuteronomy chapter 26, God told the children of Israel, when it is time of harvest, You will take the first of the fruit, the first fruit. You will put it in a basket. Then you will take it unto the temple. And then you will give it unto the priest that shall be in those days. The priest will take the basket out of your hand and put it on the altar of God. Then when the priest has finished that, you will begin to say, a Syrian ready to perish was my father. And we sojourned in Egypt. And then we became very populous. And the Egyptians entreated us and oppressed us, but when we cried unto the Lord our God, the Lord heard our cries, and he brought us out, even out of that dungeon, out of that slavery, with a mighty hand, with an outstretched arm. And the Lord brought us out, and he has settled us in this place, a land flowing with milk and honey. Priest, look, this is the fruit for this year from the land that the Lord my God gave unto me. That's why I brought this gratitude. God said the children of Israel should do their offering like that. Should bring their tithe with an attitude of gratitude. That God, I was in bondage, but with your powerful hand, you took me out of bondage. I was penniless. I had nothing, but you put me in a land flowing with milk and honey. You gave me opportunity. You put me in a large place. And now look at how provision is coming into my life. I brought this one to appreciate you. We must bring it with an attitude of gratitude. When you bring your tithe, you don't bring it as a, it's because they said that if I didn't bring the tithe now, God will not rebuke the devourer for my sake. That's a bad attitude. Let's even say that there is no blessing that follows tithe. You know we should tithe? Ah, gratitude. I learned something many years ago. There were some people that came from Benue State. I don't know what they call them in your own area, but in my own area, they call them the Agatus. They came from Benue State, things were tough, and they came to the West, and they came to come and do farming. And I remember that, you know, when they came to our territory, they went to the king. And they said, well, we have come, we are Nigerians, but we are Gatus, we came from all over the place there, we came to look for work, and we are working. If you can give us a piece of land, not that we're going to own, it's your own, but while we are here, we can farm it to be able to eat. And the KBAC gave them land, the village land. Okay, as long as you are here, farm it and eat. So what they will do, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, maybe Thursday, they will go and work for other people so that they can be paid. They can use that to buy fish. They can use that to buy oil. They can use that to buy meat. They can use that to buy bread. Then maybe on Friday, Saturday, they will farm their own land for what they are going to eat, the yam, the maize, the banana, and co. You know what I discovered? When the time of harvest comes, they will take part of that provision and they will go to the KBAC. The KBAC didn't ask them to bring anything. He was just having mercy on them that as long as you are here, just farm it and eat and survive. But they will take it to the KBAC and say, you didn't know us from anywhere. We came here. You could have rejected us, or you accepted us into your territory. We asked for favor. You gave us land. KBAC, we farmed that land. And we have harvested this year. We brought this token for you. Do you think the KBAC will be happy?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
That's gratitude. He didn't ask them to bring anything, but they, of their own volition, they brought. If KBAC has more land, they will give to them. Add this one to that one and farm it again. That's exactly what we are doing. When you bring that, God is giving you provision, and you say, God, I'm grateful. There are many people that are looking for work. It's not that I'm better than them, but you've given me work. You've given me tempo indeterminato. I'm grateful. My family, we don't lack. I'm always receiving. Oh God, every month as I get, this is your own. As a gratitude, you've given me health to work. There are people that want to work. They don't have the health. Hospital all every single time. You know, fainting every time. You have strength. You have, you know, everything. You are not falling sick. Opportunity is there. There are people working in companies that the companies are folding up. They are retrained. But your own company is going. Is it your making? Is the goodness of God? Come with the attitude of gratitude. Come like Abel, the firstling of the flock. He brought it and he offered it. And I pray that as we are learning from this excellent worshiper, we will use it to improve and fine-tune our own worship in Jesus' name.
Amen. Like I said,
who has been an excellent worshiper, but who is going to be a more excellent worshiper in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Like I see somebody that God is saying, you are worshiping me, but it's not really as I would have desired. I'm praying that with the insights you are getting tonight, you'll be able to fine-tune your worship and raise it to a higher level that will be acceptable to God, that God will be able to acknowledge your gift, and God will be able to testify of your, you know, of your worship as he did to Abel in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank God, because Abel was an excellent worshiper. And yet the Bible says, with all that excellent worship, don't look unto Abel, look unto Jesus. So the second point is looking unto our excellent wonder. Although we can learn from an excellent worshiper like Abel, we are commanded to look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Of course, Abel offered the more excellent sacrifice by faith. We are to look unto the author and the finisher of that faith. Abel should not be our focus. Jesus should be our focus. Why is that so? Number one, Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice, but Jesus is our excellent and final sacrifice himself. I've already shown you the sacrifice of Abel. It was going to be the first of many sacrifices, but Jesus offered only one sacrifice. It was final. The sacrifice to cancel all sacrifices. The sacrifice to abolish every other sacrifice. The sacrifice, the only sacrifice, the final sacrifice, the sufficient sacrifice. Oh, how can you compare that? Instead of looking unto Abel, you need to look unto Jesus. Do you know another thing? Abel only provided an example. Abel said, look at me. The way I've done it, if you do it that way, God will acknowledge your gift. But Jesus did not only provide an example, he also provided an exhortation. We don't read in the Bible how Abel taught us how to worship, you know, by teaching. No, Abel didn't. We just saw his example, how he did it, and we can follow that example. But we can see the example of how Jesus worshiped, how he sacrificed. But not only that, he taught. That woman is so told, that woman said, I perceive you are a prophet. All these things you are saying. I perceive you. Let's see. In John chapter 4, let's see what that woman said. And tonight, so you can see in respect of that, how Jesus is greater than Abel. John chapter 4, I read to you from, you know, from verse 19. John chapter 4, from verse 19. The woman said unto her, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus said unto her, this is teaching now. This is exhortation now. There's no exhortation from Abel. We saw his example, but no exhortation. But this exhortation from Jesus. You want to be an excellent worshiper? Let me teach you how to be. Then Jesus, in verse 21, Jesus said unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when we shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Jesus said, the place where you are worshiping God is not the most important. Whether in Samaria or Jerusalem, that doesn't matter. The physical place is not the most important teaching, and you are hearing tonight. We thank God we can meet physically. But you know where we are meeting now? This one is called a virtual place. The church is a real place. We see eye to eye. Here we are seeing eye to eye, but in a figure, virtual. And whether a real place or a virtual place, we can worship God. And Jesus said, whether in Samaria or Jerusalem, you are worshiping God. So he told her that in verse 20, And in verse 21, the time cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Verse 22, ye worship, ye know not what. You know not what. We know
worship,
for salvation is of the Jews. Christ said, hey, you are even worshiping ignorantly. You don't even know what you are worshiping. But let me teach you proper. Salvation is of the Jews. Real worship has its roots in what God, the covenants of promise that God has given to the Jews. Without it, you can't worship aright. You will be doing things wrong. Verse 23, he says, but the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is his spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So Jesus did not only provide an example of excellent worship, he gave exhortation about excellent worship. He taught it. Already, he gave an example in Matthew chapter 4 to tell you that only God is worthy of our worship. Satan says, worship me. Christ said, no, I can't worship you. You worship God only. We can see his example. But here now, we see his teaching, his exhortation. So when you compare Abel and Jesus, what do you see? Abel only left us an example, but Jesus left us an example and also gave us an exhortation. What a wonderful Savior. What a wonderful Redeemer. So we need to understand that Abel only provided an example of how to offer an excellent sacrifice. Jesus provided both an example and an exhortation of how to offer an excellent sacrifice and worship. Jesus gave more than an example. Jesus demonstrated by a personal example that worship is not to be given to or wasted on Satan. God only deserves our worship. Jesus also exhorted us that those who worship God must worship God in spirit and in truth. He taught much about worship. You know, in Matthew chapter 15, he told those people and said, you think that you are worshiping. Your worship is hypocritical. You are drawing near to God with your mouth, but your heart is, going after your covetousness. You know what he said? People have said, the way these people worship, when you look at the external, and Christ said, no, worship goes beyond the external. It goes inside. God is looking at the attitude of heart. And then he says, these people, their heart is already going after their covetousness, but they are worshiping God with their mouth. We can see that. Jesus taught. So Abel, only an example. Jesus, example and exhortation. Number three. Number three, very important. I said number three, very important.
Amen.
Sacrifice was only valid for one person, himself. Do you see that Cain had to offer his own sacrifice? Because Abel's sacrifice did not cover Cain. Abel's sacrifice did not cover their parents, Adam and Eve. They had to offer their own sacrifice. Abel's sacrifice was only valid for one person, himself alone. How about Jesus' sacrifice? Jesus' sacrifice is valid for all. Can you see how Jesus is greater than Abel? Sacrifice for only one, that's Abel, only himself. But the sacrifice of Jesus, valid for everybody. Abel's sacrifice was only valid, for one, himself. Abel's sacrifice did not cover his parents. Adam and Eve were not covered. It did not cover his brother Cain. Cain had to offer his own sacrifice. But Jesus' sacrifice is valid for all people and in all places. Hebrews chapter 2, in verse 9. I believe that by God's grace, by the time we finish tonight, you will appreciate who Jesus is.
Amen.
Yes. Compare him with other heroes of faith, you will know that by far, there's no comparison. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9. It says, but we see Jesus. Are you seeing Jesus?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Look unto Jesus. Are you seeing Jesus?
Yes, sir.
But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for how many?
Every man.
For every man. A sacrifice, he died, his death is for every man. God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. That sacrifice is valid for the entire and for the entire globe. It's valid for all men, all people in all places. But Abel's sacrifice was only valid for him. It didn't cover his brother, Cain. It did not cover his parents, Adam and Eve. It was only valid for him. So how do you want to compare those two sacrifices? The sacrifice that Jesus offered is valid for the blacks, is valid for the whites, is valid for the literate, is valid for the illiterate, is valid for the rich, is valid for the poor, is valid for the sick, is valid for the healthy, valid for all people in all places. Oh, I pray that you will understand what Jesus has done for you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You know what Jesus Christ said? He gave his life a ransom for all, valid for everybody. Now, number four, Jesus, Abel's sacrifice was only valid for one time. I told you that if Abel were to live longer, if Cain had not killed Abel, that will never be the only sacrifice that Abel will offer. That's the first sacrifice. 1 month later, he has to offer another one. 3 months later, another one. 1 year later, another one. Abel will have to offer sacrifices all throughout his life. That sacrifice that we are reading in Hebrews chapter, in Genesis chapter 4, that sacrifice was only valid for that one time. But you know what? Jesus' sacrifice is valid for all time. What a sacrifice. What a sacrifice. In Hebrews chapter 10, because you see, where we cannot look unto Abel, we can learn from Abel. Why we cannot look unto Abel, but we must look unto Jesus. Hebrews chapter 10, let me read to you in verse 11, and then I will come back to verse 11. It says, and every priest stand there daily, ministering and offering oftentimes, even during the day. They are standing daily, they are ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. They will offer that sacrifice 7 times in the day. It doesn't take away sin. Tomorrow they are going to offer another one. Next tomorrow they are going to offer another one. Oftentimes, many times, during the day, continually. But look at verse 12. But this man, after he had offered how many sacrifices?
One sacrifice.
One sacrifice for sin. For how long?
Forever.
Sat down on the right hand of God. Some people don't understand that. Let me give you this. Do you know heaven is like the reality of the Holy of Holies in the tabernacle and in the temple? In the Holy of Holies, there is no seat. The high priest cannot sit down because his job was never done. He knows that I've offered the sacrifice for this year on the Day of Atonement. Next year is coming, and the upper year is coming. So there is no seat. But in the real Holy of Holies in heaven, there is a seat. After Jesus finished, you can rest. It is when you finish your work and it is finished, you can rest. What a difference. Offered one offering for sins. Forever, he sat down. Job done. It is finished. Can you see the difference? Abel's sacrifice was valid for just that time. It's not valid for any other time. He has to do other sacrifices. But Jesus' sacrifice is valid for all time. So Abel's sacrifice was only valid for one time. That particular time in which he offered the sacrifice, Abel would have had to offer other sacrifices for other times. But Jesus' sacrifice is valid for all time. For all time. In verse 14, for by one offering, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 14, for by one offering, not many, for by one offering, He has perfected forever them that are sanctified. Perfected forever. One offering valid for all time, effective for all time, no other sacrifice. Can you see that difference? Number five, Abel is the first recorded excellent worshiper, and Jesus is the last excellent worshiper. We are still worshiping, but how can your own be like that of Jesus? He taught us how to worship. He was worship personified. Just like Adam was the first Adam and Jesus was the last Adam, that's what the Bible says. Abel was the first worshiper, and it's like Jesus being the last and the ultimate worshiper. You want to know how to worship God, pattern your life after Jesus, and you will. It's the perfect example that never made a mistake, that did it right every single time. Abel is the first recorded excellent worshiper, and Jesus is the last excellent worshiper who came to show us how to properly worship God in spirit and in truth. Some people have been worshiping God before. It was all physical. And Christ said, no, worship goes beyond the physical. God is looking at the heart. The Pharisees thought worship was only external, just singing with the mouth. The melody that people can hear, and then the expressions that people can see. But Jesus Christ said, no, God is watching your heart at the same time. You worship God in the spirit and in truth. It's important. And he told those people and said, you are worshiping God, you know, with your mouth. You draw near. You sing glorious songs. You tell God, I love you. I love you, Lord. And I want to do this for you. But he says, but your heart goeth after his covetousness. That's not worship. He's the one that came to teach us and to tell us this is the way to worship. Worship goes beyond the physical. Worship, God is evaluating what man cannot see. Man can see, you know, the things you are bringing. Man can see the way you are structuring your worship, the ones that we can see with our eyes. But God is watching the one that man cannot see, how things are going on in your heart. So you can see that. Number six. Abel gave the best of his flock, but Jesus gave his best, his whole life. Do you know that Abel didn't offer himself? Abel offered another. Abel offered the firstling of his flock. Let me ask you here, have you ever seen an animal when you want to offer that animal and you tell the animal, animal, it's a good day today, you know? Today I want to offer you as a sacrifice for myself, for atonement. And the animal will come and say, oh, master, I love you a lot. I want to die for you. Have you ever seen an animal like that?
No, sir.
There is no animal that is sacrificed that is willing. As you are taking that animal to the stocks to go and sacrifice, the animal, leave me alone now. Let me go. Why must you kill me today? The animal is complaining, but you are dragging the animal. The animal is unwilling to die. Have you ever seen an animal that voluntarily donates himself for you to sacrifice it, to shed his blood for your sin? It never happens. Abel offered an animal that was unwilling, an animal that did not volunteer to die. But let's look at John chapter 10. Let's look at the sacrifice of Jesus. Let's look at the sacrifice of Jesus. There is no animal that voluntarily dies. There is no animal that willingly offers himself on your behalf. No, we have to force that animal. We have to kill that animal. That's why we have to tie the animal so that it does not run away. And we have to hold it down and then slaughter it. But look at what Jesus said. John chapter 10. Verse 11, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life
for the sheep.
He wasn't forced. He gave his life for the sheep. Verse 15, and the Father knoweth me, even so know I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep.
For the sheep.
He wasn't forced. He laid down his life. It was voluntary. It was willing. Verse 17. Therefore, doth my Father love me, because I laid down my life that I might take it again. Look at verse 18. No man taketh my life from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. This commandment have I received of my Father. So it was willing. It was voluntary. Nobody forced him. He laid down his life for us. Willing offering. Willing sacrifice. Voluntary sacrifice. How can you compare that sacrifice with the sacrifice of Abel? That lamb did not die willingly. That lamb did not die voluntarily. Abel had to take it, tie it, make sure it doesn't run away, hold it down, and slaughter it, and shed the blood. But Jesus Christ said, no, I shed my blood, but it was willing. I shed my blood, it was voluntary. I laid down my life for the sheep. I laid down my life for you. So as you compare, how then can we be looking unto Abel? We thank God for Abel. We thank God for the example that he left. We thank God for what we can learn from the way he worshipped God. But looking unto Jesus. Let's go back to Hebrews chapter 12. Maybe you are understanding bit by bit tonight as we look at all these characters one by one by the grace of God to see what we can learn from them. But looking unto Jesus, we thank God for Abel, we thank God for Enoch, we thank God for Noah, we thank God for Abraham, thank God for Sarah, thank God for Jacob, thank God for Isaac, thank God for Joseph, thank God for Moses, thank God for all these people, David and Barak and Jephthah and Samuel, Gideon and Go. But the Bible says, looking unto Jesus. The heroes of faith have gone, and many of them, wonderful, wonderful men of God, but looking unto Jesus. Very, very important. Very, very important. Hebrews chapter 12 again, looking unto Jesus. In verse 1, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, all this great cloud of witnesses from Hebrews chapter 11 surrounding us and occupying the galleries of faith, and then they are there encouraging us, cheering us on in our race, in our fight, good fight of faith, in our race, running the race that is set before us, they are cheering us on. Yet, the Bible says, despite being surrounded, despite being compassed about with this so great a cloud of witnesses, yet in verse 2 it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. As you compare Jesus with Abel, far greater than Abel in very many respects. Abel's sacrifice could not take away sins. Was the sacrifice of bulls and goats. But Jesus' sacrifice, behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. Abel's sacrifice, valid for only one person, himself alone. He couldn't even cover his brother Cain, not to talk about his parents. But Jesus' sacrifice is valid for all people in all places. Abel's sacrifice, valid for just that time alone. But Jesus' sacrifice, valid for all time. How can you compare Jesus with Abel? Abel had to offer something else, somebody else. It had to offer. He couldn't die by himself. He offered a lamb, but Jesus offered himself. What a better sacrifice for us. He offered one sacrifice forever, perfected his people forever. One sacrifice that ends all sacrifices. What a wonder. That's why we said, looking unto our excellent wonder. Jesus did not only sacrifice, he himself is the sacrifice, the only sacrifice, the final sacrifice, the effective sacrifice, the sacrifice that ends all sacrifices. No more sacrifice. And those who are still going to Oracle, what sacrifice are you offering? There is no more sacrifice. The final sacrifice has been offered. The only effective sacrifice has been offered. If you are doing that, they're just eating your money. They're just eating chicken and the things. And then if we sacrifice for you, your problems will be over. The problem has just started because you are sacrificing to demons. The Bible says the things with the Gentile sacrifice, they sacrifice not to God, but they sacrifice unto demons, unto Satan. It's a satanic sacrifice. All sacrifices have been ended with the sacrifice, the only effective final sacrifice of Jesus. We should look unto Jesus, the Lamb of God, that taketh away the sins of the world. Abel was an excellent worshiper, but we have in Jesus a much more excellent worshiper. Abel left us an example, but Jesus not only left us an example, he gave us an exhortation. And as you look at the two, you look at Abel, you look at Jesus, there is no comparison. There is no comparison. The gap is wide. Abel offered an excellent sacrifice by faith, but Jesus even is the author and finisher of that faith that Abel used in offering a more excellent sacrifice. How can you compare the author with the user? How can you compare the manufacturer of a car with the person that has just bought the car and is using it? You are different, as the manufacturer of the car is far higher than just the user and the driver of the car. So much more is Jesus, the author of the finisher of our faith, much more higher than the guy that is just, you know, offering an excellent sacrifice by faith unto God. And tonight, the Lord is telling you, looking unto Jesus. Maybe you have learned from Abel. Maybe you've been looking unto Abel. I said, I pray I will be like Abel. Bible says, no, pray that you will be like Jesus. Learn from Abel, but look unto Jesus. Learn from Abel, look unto Jesus. Whatever Abel did that God could acknowledge his gift, learn how you could use it to improve your worship so that God could acknowledge your gift, but look unto Jesus. That's a perfect example. That's the more excellent worshiper. That's the one that the sacrifice he offered, you can't compare it with the sacrifice of Abel. And I pray that as you, you know, understand this tonight, that Jesus is our excellent wonder and we are to look unto him. Tonight is a comparison of Jesus and Abel. And why we learn from Abel, but we look unto Jesus. And I pray that the Lord himself, with all the information and the things you are learning, I believe that your spiritual knowledge is enhanced, that now you will see more. Now you can see better. Abel offered, his sacrifice was only valid for him. But thank God, the sacrifice of the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world is valid for me, is valid for you. Amen. Yesterday, today, and forever.
Amen.
All people, valid in all places, valid for all time. That's why somebody can get saved in Ghana and somebody can get saved in Italy. Valid all places. That's why a white man can get saved and a black man can get saved. Valid for all people. And that's why somebody was saved 2 years ago. Somebody else is getting saved today and somebody else will get saved tomorrow. Valid for all time. What a sacrifice. Far better, far greater than the sacrifice that Abel offered. And I pray that as you look over Jesus, you will be a better worshiper.
Amen.
You will be able to enhance your worship with all the things we have talked about tonight. Let's rise up and pray and tell the Lord that he will help us. He will help us, that he will look unto our excellent wonder. You will learn from Abel, an excellent worshiper, but you look unto Jesus, our excellent wonder. You learn from Abel, but you look unto Jesus. You learn from Abel, but you look unto Jesus. You learn from Abel, but you look unto Jesus. Learn from Abel, look unto Jesus. Learn from Abel, look unto Jesus. Abel followed an established order by God. You also, you must follow an established order by God. Abel offered God the first and the best. You also must offer God the first and the best. Because a great God deserves a great gift. Abel knew and showed us that atonement is only possible through the blood. There is no other way into the kingdom. Is the way of the blood. Atonement is by the blood. Forgiveness is by the blood. Redemption is by the blood. Salvation is by the blood. Abel offered the sacrifice with a heart of gratitude and thanksgiving. As you offer your sacrifice, come with an attitude of thanksgiving. Come with an attitude of gratitude. Gratitude to God for sparing your life. Gratitude to God for giving you opportunity. Gratitude to God for the provision in your life. Gratitude to God for the health He has given you. Gratitude to God. Come with an attitude of gratitude. Very, very important. Those are the things we are learning from Abel. And you are learning it tonight. You are learning it, my brother. You are learning it tonight. Abel, you can learn from an excellent worshiper. But after you have learned from an excellent worshiper, look unto our excellent wonder. What a wonderful Savior. Jesus is a wonder. Jesus is a wonder. He didn't only offer sacrifice, He is the sacrifice. He didn't only offer just one sacrifice, He was the sacrifice. The final sacrifice, the only sacrifice, the sacrifice that ends all sacrifices, the effective sacrifice, no other sacrifice. It's a final sacrifice that abolishes all other sacrifices. Oh, you can. He left us not just like Abel an example, but also He gave us an exhortation. He went beyond Abel. Abel left us only an example. Jesus left us an example and an exhortation. Look at it. Abel's sacrifice, valid for himself alone, but Jesus' sacrifice, valid for all people in all places. Abel's sacrifice, only valid for that time he sacrificed, but Jesus' sacrifice, valid for all time. And the lamb that Abel offered was unwilling.
Thank you.
He didn't volunteer.
What you have
it was a willing sacrifice. He laid down His life for us. He was a voluntary sacrifice. Nobody took His life from Him down by Himself. But we need to worship Him. We need to praise Him tonight. We need to appreciate and understand Him all the more tonight. My brother, this is Jesus. That's why the Bible says, looking unto Jesus. Tonight, looking unto Jesus. Tonight, looking unto Jesus. Tonight, looking unto Jesus. Tonight, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Offered unto God by faith, but Jesus is the author and finisher of that faith. Greater. This is the opportunity for looking unto our excellent wonder. Look unto Him. Look unto Jesus. Let your focus be on Him. He's the one that can never make a mistake. He's the one that always does it right. He's the incomparable one.
But to look unto You, my excellent one.
Oh,
just tell the Lord tonight. Tonight is your night. It's your night, my brother. It's your night, my sister. Night of blessing, night of exaltation. Night of exaltation. This is a night that God is taking you to the place of victory, taking you to the place of honor, taking you to the place.
Yes, Lord, help me to look unto You, Lord, every moment of every day, in every situation.
Are there challenges in your life? Look unto Jesus. You need healing? Look unto Jesus. You need salvation? Look unto Jesus. You need deliverance? Look unto Jesus. You need provision in your life? Look unto Jesus. You need refreshing? Look unto Jesus. You need renewal and revival? Look unto Jesus. Whatever you need, looking unto Jesus, He supplies every need. He supplies every need. Whatever need you brought to the platform tonight, looking unto Jesus, He will supply. He will supply by faith, tap into the resources of heaven. By faith, come to Jesus and have your needs met. You need peace, He's the Prince of Peace. You need provision, He's the one that will supply all your needs according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Whatever you need tonight, by faith, come to Jesus. He will supply. Come to Jesus. You need forgiveness. He will supply. You need cleansing. He will give whatever you need. Jesus, look unto Him. 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 Wonderful, wonderful. Look unto Him. Our excellent wonder. It's our excellent wonder. Perfect Messiah in every sense. He has offered one sacrifice and perfected everything forever. When He says it is finished, it was finished. No other sacrifice, it is finished. No other thing you need to do for salvation, it is finished.
You are the way.
It is a final sacrifice for you and for me.
You are the situation. You are the challenger remover. Oh Lord God Almighty, Father, Lord Jesus,
thank you,
in Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you tonight as we compare Abel with Jesus. We thank you for the life of Abel. We thank you for the example he set and he left for us. He didn't have a Bible, but even what he did is still an example. He followed your order. He showed us that atonement is only by the blood. He offered you his first and his best. And he offered with a heart of gratitude. And Abel said, you've seen my example. God testified of my gifts. God acknowledged my sacrifice. God can acknowledge your sacrifice. God can testify of your sacrifice if you do it the same way. And tonight, we have learned from Abel, an excellent worshiper, but we are looking unto Jesus. We are looking unto Jesus because when we compare Him with Abel, there is no comparison. As the heaven is far higher than the earth, so is Jesus far higher than Abel. They may look alike, but that's where it ends. But the gap is wide. Oh Lord, as we learn from Abel, help us to look unto Jesus.
Amen.
We look up unto you. You are the source of our salvation. You are the source of our cleansing. You are the source of forgiveness and redemption. You are the source of our healing. You are the source of every single thing we need in life. Those who need peace, you are the Prince of Peace. Those who need provision, Paul said, my God shall supply your need according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. You are the one that can supply our need. I'm praying that all my brethren here on the platform tonight, as by faith they look unto Jesus, every need will be met in Jesus' name. Those who are confused, those who are disturbed, those who are in pandemonium, I pray that as you look unto Jesus, the Prince of Peace, I command peace in your life in Jesus' name. Peace to reign in every storm that you are passing through in Jesus' name. I pray that the peace of God that passeth all understanding will keep your heart in Jesus' name. Those who need provision according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus, it will provide for you in Jesus' name. Those who feel defiled and dirty and they are saying, oh God, I need your cleansing. Thank God, because the Bible says when we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I pray that blood that was shed at Calvary, use it to cleanse them from all unrighteousness in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Those who need provision, those who need protection, oh Lord, as that angel of judgment passes by, and when he sees the blood of Jesus covering your people, he will pass over in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Those who are fighting and they are in warfare, fierce warfare, I pray that by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony, they will overcome Satan and his agents in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Every need tonight as we look up unto you, they are granted.
Amen.
As we tap unto you, as we reach out unto the resources of heaven by faith, tonight everybody on the platform, receive your healing, receive your miracle, receive your deliverance, receive your renewal, receive your revival, receive your refreshing. Everything you are looking up unto God, and you came this evening to say, God, I'm looking up unto you, do this in my life. Oh Lord, I pray those things, do it in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord, because as we look unto you by faith, every need is met.
Amen.
We magnify your mighty name.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name, I pray.
Amen. Amen.